Welcome back. While the Philippines is home of the Asian Development Bank, it's been 9 years since the bank held its annual meeting here. It's doing so this year, which the government hopes will showcase what it says is the improved economic and business climate here. What's the ADB doing in and for the Philippines? With us tonight is the bank's VP for Operations, Stephen Groff. Thanks for joining us, Steve.
Salamat po.
Okay, let's begin with what the government says. The government is saying there's going to be a showcase for the Philippines, this ADB meeting. Lots of Asian leaders coming here, of course. Do they get the chance to see the Philippines? Could it function as a showcase?
Well, I think it is really an opportunity, Coco, to showcase the Philippines. There could be about 4,000 people coming here for the annual meeting. So there's will be a lot to see, a lot to talk about. You'll have leaders from the entire region coming through. So I think it is really a good opportunity.
And what do they get to see? Many of these leaders we know would be shuttling from their hotel room to the convention center. But what can the Philippines do to show them that the Philippines is, as the government says, reopened for business?
Well, I think part of it is those leaders, of course, many of the leaders will be here for limited periods of time, but they will come with large delegations of people who will come early, maybe stay a little bit longer. But I think also just the idea of doing it in the Philippines, the PICC, there's been a lot of work that's been done at the PICC. It looks great. So we're confident that it's a real opportunity, a great opportunity for the Philippines.
Okay. So you're in charge, or one of the people in charge of ADB operations. I mean, many of us know the ADB has a lot of economists, a lot of thinking goes on there, a lot of planning. You're one of those people who implements all these plans. Let's talk about the problems with improving the poverty or the economic situation in the Philippines. What are the standout problems when it comes to the Philippines?
Well, I think one thing in the Philippines is we've seen a lot of improvements lately. The macroeconomic climate, the macroeconomic situation in the Philippines right now is great. You know, you have low debt, have good solid banks, low inflation. So these are good things for the country. So there's a lot of things to be positive about. But one problem that the country has suffered from over the last couple of decades is an inability to translate the growth that we've seen, an average of 4.8% over the last 10 years, into poverty reduction.
When you compare us with our neighbors, for example, the Philippine economy seems to be, according to ADB, less pro-poor, less inclusive, hindered by rapid population growth. And also there seems to be a lack of a coherent or effective jobs program here. When they say less inclusive, what does that mean? That means some people are getting rich, but a lot of people are staying poor or not getting any better.
What it means is that you've seen this economic growth, but it hasn't really trickled down to the poorest. And part of that is that there hasn't been a structural transformation in the economy that has allowed industry and manufacturing to grow, that provides higher productivity types of jobs for the poor. And so the poor remain, you know, mired in primary production. So they haven't been able to climb that ladder out of poverty, and that's what a lot of regional countries have done in order to resolve that problem.
When you talk about regional countries, you're talking about the neighbors. Who has done a good job there? We were talking about Thailand, for example. Why is Thailand more successful than the Philippines?
Well, Thailand has focused a bit more on industrial policy. Indonesia has done more work in that area. Malaysia, obviously. Malaysia has its own challenges, being a bit stuck in a middle income trap at the moment. But, you know, China, of course, is another example, a big neighbor to the north. But these are countries that have focused a lot on thinking about how do you make sure that you have a continuum from, you know, low productivity jobs to higher productivity
jobs. And why hasn't the Philippines been able to focus on that or been able to implement those kinds of policies?
Well, I think that in some ways the country has had steady growth. It's been insulated from a lot of the global economic shocks that we've seen over the last couple of decades. In part, that's due to remittances. Remittances are a good thing for the economy. The economy allows the economy to absorb these shocks, but it also has meant that the economy hasn't suffered from some shocks that might result in some change in the way that we look at the economy.
So the governments haven't been forced to make some decisions or some choices along the way.
That certainly could be part of it.
Right. And when we talk about what the ADB tries to define as a way out of this poverty, you're talking about promoting inclusive growth, talking about supporting social safety nets, and also expanded or improved social services. Let's go back to inclusive growth. What can the government do to make growth more inclusive?
Well, the government can, again, work with the private sector to find ways to incentivize investments in manufacturing and industry. The government can diversify its export markets, diversify its exports to the region and globally. Government can invest in infrastructure. Investments in infrastructure at rate of GDP are about half of regional comparators, and also social services, as you say, education, health, critically important.
When you talk about inclusive growth, trying to build that up will take what from the government?
I think what it's going to take is going to take thinking a little bit more about these issues, thinking more about investing in health and education at the lower end, in infrastructure, industrial policy, and manufacturing.
You mentioned industrial policy. Everyone knows that the sunrise industry in the Philippines now, I don't know if it's still sunrise already, noontime, is the BPO industry. What's wrong with that?
BPO has been great for the economy. You know, you've seen a tremendous growth in BPO over the last decade. The issue, though, is, of course, that employs only 1% of the labor force, and it's the higher end of that labor force, the more skilled. So you need to find manufacturing jobs for the lower end of the labor force.
For our viewers, you're speaking from experience here. You've been coming back to the Philippines for a couple of decades now. You actually have worked in Bataan, Palawan, Mindanao, Peace Corps, and other organizations. What changes have you seen in that period of time?
Well, there's been a lot of positive changes over the 25 years that have been coming into the Philippines. And I think that the question is, you know, are we now at a moment where the Philippines can capitalize on, you know, tremendous human resource potential, tremendous, you know, natural resources that exist within the country, and I think an improving investment climate. And I think this government has shown dedication to that goal, and so we'll just have to see if we can go through.
Now, one of the things that was in the news recently is an e-trike program. It's a government PPP program, but the ADB has a role in that as well. It's actually going to loan the government, is it about 13 billion?
It's about 300 million.
Sorry, 300 million for that program. Why e-trikes?
Well, I think one thing that one of the focuses of this government, one of the focuses on ADB is both inclusive growth but also environmentally sustainable growth. The country is still remains quite dependent on petroleum products. This is one way of diversifying away from that.
Let's talk about how a program like that engenders inclusive growth. What's the mechanic there?
Well, the mechanic there is by providing...
Because I guess that's the kind of example we're looking for, a program like that that's going to address these points
sure.
you're talking
I mean,
about.
A better example, perhaps, of inclusive growth in what ADB supports. This is, I think, the e-trikes program will have inclusive growth components, but the center of it is going to be on environmentally sustainable growth. The work that we're doing on conditional cash transfers with the government is a better example.
This is the Punta with Pamilya.
Exactly.
Program. Essentially, it's cash handouts to families to keep their children in school, to keep their children well-nourished.
Prenatal care.
Now, why is that an inclusive growth program?
Because what it does is it provides the incentives for families to make the investments in their children, in that next generation, that's going to give them opportunity once they get older.
Why is it taking the world so long to think up the conditional cash transfer program? It's very popular in South America. It started here, I guess, about 5, 6, 7 years ago. Why is it taking the world so long to come up with a program that I think most people admire?
Well, I think it's just we innovate and we change over time. You experiment, you test things, and it just takes time to find the right mix. And I think, you know, Pantawid Pilipino is an example of that.
Okay, Steve, thank you very much for joining us, and good luck with the summit.
Thank you.